All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining us. I know everyone's got a busy schedule, and we're pleased that you came for what I hope is going to be a very interesting conversation. My name's Elizabeth Guider. I'm the editor of The Hollywood Reporter, and I have the honor and pleasure of sitting here with two very, very interesting producers. To my immediate right is Rola Bauer, who is the co-founder of Tandem, which is based in Germany. Company is about 11 years old, and Rola's slightly more than 11 because she had a job before that. She started out in Canada working for Alliance before it was Alliance Atlantis.
Absolutely.
Then when she moved to Europe, she worked for ProSieben, and you were just this international co-production maven of all mavens.
Only two companies hired me.
Okay, there we go. And then to her immediate right is David Zucker, who is the president of Scott Free Television in the U.S., and he's been with Ridley and Tony Scott's company for, I'm guessing, about a decade.
Almost,
and I think before that, I know that he was at Lorimar and Warner Brothers, which, of course, is also a major force in television in the U.S. And these two, in some ways, you know, it's very unlikely nowadays to see international co-productions, transatlantic ones that work on both sides of the Atlantic. So it's I think what you're going to hear about is how they managed to put this together, how they managed to raise the money, get this fabulous casting, get the rights, hold on to the rights, and convince broadcasters to take it and air it, and then where we go from here. It's a lot to talk about in 30 minutes. We'll do about 20 minutes of conversation, and then we're counting on you to stay awake and have some really snappy questions, and you will raise your hand, we'll call on you, and you can ask the questions that are most crucial to you. But let me start by, I think what we'll do is start by showing a little trailer of Pillars of the Earth. It may be from the how Starz aired it, I'm not sure, but in any case, let's go to the videotape. Surely they'll know what I'm saying here, right? Let's go to the videotape.
So war begins again, and chaos is king.
You will favor the church in all your dealings.
You have brought the wrath of God upon yourselves.
A cathedral is our compass to God, and that's why I must build one.
We need to show the king how devoted this parish is to the building of our new cathedral.
There is no king, there is no queen, there is no law in this land.
My freedom is not for sale.
Spare his life, I beg you, for mercy's sake.
If you attack us, you attack the throne.
Because of your treachery, England has been steeped in blood for 16 years.
Whom do you love the most?
I will never...
I love you, Aliena.
I will go away and you'll never see me again. Is that what you want?
You better not take us!
Try to finish your cathedral now.
It's my work.
It's your life.
This cathedral is more than just stone and wood and mud. It is hope's fragile shell on earth.
I swear by all that's holy, you'll never build your church.
I loved her!
Yeah! And with you and the Pope in power, think how the people will suffer.
The blood of your wives and children will be avenged.
For our church, dear God, I would do anything.
Let me start by asking you, how did the idea of trying to put together a miniseries based on a novel that's that thick about the 12th century, the building of a cathedral, you know, a part of history that we're not really that focused on, especially in America. How did the idea come about, And how did you acquire the rights?
Well, actually, the idea generated from Scott Free, in that they started about 10 years ago with FX, and I will pass it on to David and then maybe take it up from there.
Basically, I think 2003, we sold it with CAA because Ken Follett had really never wanted to license this as a film. He felt you needed a minimum of 6 hours to really tell the story appropriately. It was at the time Ridley was doing Kingdom of Heaven, so the sword and sandal movies were still somewhat popular in the States, though quickly on the decline. But we put it in development with the writer John Pielmeyer. We wrote a two-hour and then a Bible, and then the head of the network left. So the project got put on the shelf. We had met around that same time, and I would say there wasn't a year that passed when Rola and I wouldn't have a discussion when she'd say,
about pillars.
So how can we make this? So how can we make this? And the answer always was, well, this both the format as well as the challenge of it being an historical piece made it difficult to identify a broadcaster in the U.S. who could anchor it. Mm-hmm. And that's where it really became incumbent upon on what Tandem was really able to ultimately raise and make this a reality so we could bring it back to the U.S.
Yeah. So let's talk about that mm-hmm. kind of reverse effort where you start out in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
How did that come about? Who was your grounding force to get it done? And take us a little bit through the stages.
Mm-hmm. Our first pillar, let's say.
Our first pillar.
Was actually Germany, and that was ProSiebenSat.1. And the book had its own grounding. We knew that it had a success all over Europe. It was not just in Germany, it was in Spain. People knew about it in France, also in Italy, as well as the England. Though in an ironic and bizarre sort of way, even though it's about a 12th century cathedral, Ken Follett didn't have a lot of support in the UK market in this book. It became much more successful in Germany and then Spain and went to other countries. When we presented it in April 2008, we got the rights. The timing was perfect because the sequel, which is 200 years later, and this is, the sequel is called World Without End, and that book was coming out into the marketplace. So it was in Ken Follett's interest to do something with it. Otherwise, he would be launching another book and nothing would be done with the first one.
So Scott Free had held on to the rights, or by that time you had them?
No, unfortunately it was FX who had the rights.
All right,
and
so,
the rights, as David said, when they reverted back to Follett, and he refused to move them. He didn't want to do anything with
them. So what was that moment when you phoned up Ken Follett or his agent,
however one does that?
What did you say that made them, okay, let's give it a go? What changed their minds?
We just kept being tenacious about it. We said, it's about time. World Without End is coming out. They knew that. They're smart people. They realized they had a property on their hand. And we had just finished working with Scott Free on The Company. So David sent this project, The Company, that we'd done together and presented it as an example to Ken Follett to say, this is what the combination of Scott Free and Tandem can do. And for any author, and The Company is based on a Robert Littell book, which some of you may know.
Mm-hmm.
So for any author to get a production as high quality as The Company and look at it and say, they can do that with my book, he was intrigued, he was fascinated, and he knew that he better do something. The timing was right.
The timing was right. He needed to go with Solid. Okay.
Exactly.
So we get, Ken Follett falls into place. It's 2008. Not a great year in the financial history of the world.
The worst fucking year to start to finance
there
anything.
There we go. Leave it to Rola. She was very, very direct
I'm
here.
I'm sorry. Excuse
okay,
me.
But clearly this is a very like a costly project. So we have people out here who are interested in one basic thing other than creativity, which is money.
And
how did you raise it? How did you get it? How did you save it? How did you tap the incentives, all that stuff?
You actually put your finger on it, Elizabeth. It's about how to save money.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, if you bring a number of broadcasters to the table and they have a respect for the creative material and they allow you to do what you do best, which is create good programming, then they don't have to carry the full freight of the financing. And that is all over the world. We have acquisitions, and we have our domestic productions all over the world. So somewhere in between, there is this thing called international co-productions, or international productions, or cooperations, or co-financing, whatever you want to call it. And that's what we were trying to show to people. We were trying to show to people we could produce a high-quality program with the right partners that would be able to show to everybody that they don't have to pay the full freight of $40 million. They would have to make some compromises because there were other partners at the table. They would have to be respectful of the creative, and they would have to recognize that on one side, the good news is they didn't have to pay all of it, but on the, let's say, bad side, if you want to call it bad side, is that they would have to allow others to have a voice creatively.
And just to amend that, yes. I think the other critical component which Rola touched on that distinguished this project, at least for us, was the protection of the creative. Mm-hmm. I think you know, we've been approached as a company, as Ridley and Tony are an international brand, and they're known for taking on some of these more ambitious pieces. But we really wanted to avoid the proverbial Euro pudding. We felt we had to deliver something that was on the scale and caliber of quality that HBO has set in our country for this type of project. And on top of that, and as Starz, who became, really our most valuable partner in this, I think, is establishing for themselves. And ultimately, it was making sure that we had, in a partnership with Tandem, a company that wasn't going to put the financial first. The financial had to be equal to the creative in the sense that we had to be looking at the product that we were making as the most important thing that serviced. Kind of like, a mother and a father and making sure that we are servicing that child.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Let's stay on the financials for a minute, and then we'll get to some of those creative issues.
I jumped the gun, I'm sorry.
But yes, financing. So first money that falls into place, license fee from Proceben, right?
Absolutely.
And then what happened then? What was next?
We had other broadcasters in Europe. Quattro, Soji Cable, was very much behind us. And then we had Sony Home Entertainment, who came in for multi-territories for home
for
entertainment.
For DVD.
For the DVD rights, exactly. And we have what's called, and we had a number of other broadcasters. So let's call that the broadcasters / distributors who gave us money against the rights.
Got it.
Then we had, and some of them had a voice attached to that, specifically ProSiebenSat.1. So they would be creatively involved in the process.
We'll get that in a minute. I'd love to know how their notes turned out and what you did with them.
I don't understand German, so they didn't.
So you didn't read them.
Okay. Exactly.
Okay, I thought we would get to that in a minute. Okay, let's stick with the finances for a second. So we've got that first phase going, and the economy's not getting much better. And
no, the economy was the worst, Elizabeth. You could not have picked a better time.
Okay, it wasn't doing terribly well.
And we also realized that on one side, while the economy was so bad and we were really trying to raise this money out of a passion project, we thought maybe out of bad comes good. What we could do with this is that we could show people that if they came to the table and gave us their trust, and Tandem's been doing this for many years, and my God, Scott Free, Ridley and Tony have been doing it for
a long time,
that maybe the combination, they could take that leap of faith and we could get involved together. Notwithstanding, we still didn't have enough money, so we went and did recce's, location scouts. We went to Ireland.
Don't say every place.
Yeah.
Don't name all the places you went to and didn't use in the end.
Yes.
You went to find out where were the, not just the beautiful castles, but who had the better incentives.
That's it.
Right?
And what's called soft money. So this is additional revenue. So you have your hard contracts from your broadcasters, and then you have the soft money, which comes from these comes from these locations that you would get a tax incentive. So if you shoot there, you get a certain amount of money back. And we have a very good bank, DZ Bank, who essentially they forward finance. They give us the money based on what's projected. They allow us to use that soft money to produce the movie.
Is that a European Union bank, or is that just a local German bank?
No, it's a local German bank. Mm-hmm. DZ Bank, fabulous bank we've used for a number of years. And when it doesn't work out, my partner, Tim Halkin, just beats them up and it works.
Okay, good. Keeps them in line. All right.
And then the third part of the financing, which was very important, because we still had a deficit. This is 30 million euros or $40 million. It's not easy to put that together with the number of broadcasters. And that had to do with a company out of Canada called Muse, which we had just finished working with, and we went to Muse, because we developed at that point, and said, could we do this as a German-Canada co-production? And we sat down and figured out creatively what that means, and we'll get into that, and how would we do it within the framework, and what Canadian broadcasters would be interested in doing it, and how would we get that last piece of the puzzle. In the end, it wasn't enough, so we took it to another level and said we have to find a bank who would give us gap financing, essentially a loan against future sales. Because as a reminder, we had no US and no UK partner.
And no French partner either,
and
right?
No French partner, okay. And no Japanese partner, and no Australian, so major key territories were open. And there, a company called FIDAC, of which we have Gilles, who's there representing FIDAC at the moment, came in and gave us a gap financing, a loan. So anybody want loan, he's over there, he has money to give.
But did he have to read Pillars of the Earth first in order to know, hey, this is going to work? I mean, how did you convince him? This is going to work, you're going to get your money back. What did you say?
We had a dinner, and they are in Montreal, Canada. And we had a dinner with a key executive, and I brought to the dinner the Pillars of the Earth in French, and because his mother language is French, and said, I hope you enjoy the book, and we have several months ahead of us.
Okay, there you go.
That was the start. He knew our company, he knew Muse, he had a comfort factor. We fought for several months on all the deals, and at the end of the day, they put a faith in us against the foreign potential revenue, the foreign sales.
Now let's go to the United States, not a country known these days for being terribly interested in cathedral building in the 12th century, okay? Just to put it bluntly. So here you are at Ridley and Tony Scott Company. You have The Good Wife. You clearly are doing wonderful things in television, but different kind of television. Mm-hmm. What do you do to go out and convince a broadcaster or a cable company to, you know, take a risk and want to air something that isn't going to air in a one-hour time slot at 10 p.m.
Well, Rola had the inspired notion to contract with a German artisan to create a very large book that we
That's why we had that sitting there. It's not that somebody didn't show up and Lisa put the book there, right? This is for that book.
I was her Sherpa.
May I move?
Okay.
Am I allowed to move?
Yeah.
Yeah. This was our relationship. David had to schlep this book everywhere.
So this was a very novel pitch meeting, wasn't it?
We would come into the pitch meetings and we would show, which really was a beautiful, Lisa Pierce, who heads up our marketing and press it, and everybody thought we were nuts. It was just as simple as that. We came in, we called it our box of chocolates. Mm-hmm. And if you see here, oh, there's a part that's missing.
Okay.
There's something
One
that's
One of the chocolates was eaten.
No.
This is like the credits, yeah.
So this gives all of the different sections. So you'd have the royal court and the nobility, the upstairs, and you'd have the downstairs. You'd have the Kingsbridge as well as the builders, the peasants, and then in between we would have information about the worldwide franchise. We would have information about the two companies, Scott-Free and Tandem. This was prior to us making the deal with Muse as a co-production. And we had information about the author, potential writers, and of course, all of the actors. So you would open up one of these boxes, and you would have all the...
Everything you wanted to know about Ian McShane or...
Well, it was projecting
Rufus,
who you thought we would cast.
We'll get
and
to that too.
Like any really good box of chocolates, you had a second layer. So that's where we would have the first 2 hours and the outline. And we left it in their office.
And it didn't work.
And then you had to call up to get the book back, right?
Oh, absolutely. Okay.
Oh, that was a different negotiation.
Oh, that was okay.
It worked in some territories and markets.
It didn't work for the Americans.
Yes. No. Okay.
So what ultimately did? Because I mean, it is hard. And broadcaster, did you immediately know we've got to go to cable? Do you want HBO and Showtime? What happened?
No, because it was the worst time possible economically, and because we'd invested a lot of time and money into this, we weren't going to let it go. We weren't going to write off everything. It was as simple as that. So with the help of partners like FIDEC, who came in with their gap financing, and the fact that we also had a co-production between Germany and Canada, which gave us some extra soft money, and shooting in Hungary, which gave us some other soft money, and the fact that Scott Free and Tandem deferred, that means put back all of their fees until we made more money, we closed the financing. And we used whatever cash we had to produce it and kept in touch with all of the US broadcasters.
Yeah, I mean, from the American point of view, you happened upon the first challenge, which was creatively this isn't something that that they were aching for. And the format as well is a challenge, to say the least, because there's very little that being done in the U.S. That said, I think, and this was also, I think, an essential sort of bond of the partnership with Tandem, is there was an incredible shared sort of passion and belief in the material. Mm-hmm. I think we knew we had, you know, sort of the holy grail of good film and television, which is a very, very strong script.
Yeah. But
and so I think the feeling that we had and why, you know, Tandem ultimately was willing to even take the gap financing risks is we knew that if we could deliver the quality production with a certain amount of serendipity, we would be able to go back into the market and find someone who couldn't resist it. It's just hard for them to take that risk out of the box.
And so in brief, because this is going to be brief, you actually started the production and the filming, obviously, so you did have a cast, you did have locations before you even actually locked down the American and the British deals.
We finished.
Yeah.
You had finished, actually.
We wrapped production. Tandem had the luck to work with Starz in terms of representing. So we always kept in touch with Starz. And Jonathan Taylor, who's there checking his BlackBerry Jonathan, we worked with Jonathan and the rest of Starz, and it was a very good relationship. And we went back to Starz.
At a very interesting moment in Starz history, too, if I'm not mistaken. I mean, with Chris Albrecht coming talk to us about
perfect,
that.
Perfect timing, because we'd kept in touch with all of the broadcasters we'd talked to, but Chris had just made his deal at Christmas. We had wrapped production at the beginning of December. He'd made his deal sometime in the middle of December with Starz, and he started his first day of work after the new year. Then, of course, emails back and forth. We had already been in touch with Starz, and then we had something to show. And by the end of January, we'd already made the deal. So the broadcasters knew about it. They had tracked it in the US. We had shown the material. In fact, we showed them another piece of material and invited them to come in to the editing suite and watch the first cut, the director's cut of the first episode, which they did. It was actually the first two episodes, the first movie. And they did. And then we gave a timeline. We said, we need to know. And we knew, as David said, we knew that we would find a home for this.
It was and the only antecedent to that, which was also an interesting challenge for us, is I'm rare, if I can't even think of any example of a project of this caliber, particularly with the acting talent that we were able to bring into it, our responsibility to Ken as well, where they took a risk with us by coming aboard a project that they believed in creatively, but we weren't telling them, because we didn't know ourselves, who was ultimately going to carry it. And it had to be not only respectable, but something that was that correlated to the quality of production we delivered. And with Chris coming on board and the timing with Starz was really ideal.
I'm also fascinated by, you know, your choice of writers on this, because since it essentially came out of Europe, you decided, though, they went with an American writer. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about that. Why that choice? Why John in particular? Of course, he acts in it too, doesn't he? So yes, you got a double whammy here.
Actually, we were saying the other day, again, perhaps the first where we have the author of the book and the screenwriter both acting in the same picture. I don't know that's ever been done
before. I bet it's a Guinness thing. I bet it is. We'll have to Google that one.
And they're both quite good. That was a byproduct of the original sale to FX. And when we initially spoke with CAA, who brought us the property, they had brought the suggestion of John as well, who happens to be a client. But he's quite brilliant at adaptation, and so it wasn't something we questioned. That was something they brought in from the start.
And he did a great first 2 hours, so it just seemed natural.
Also, if you haven't seen it yet, we will get to it with your questions. I'm seeing zero on the teleprompter. I don't know what that means. We're going to ignore it for a minute, and then someone's going to start raising their hands or something. But we're going to ignore it for a minute. I just want to talk, you know, the acting in this is, as I watched it a second time, because Starz very nicely sent me the whole DVD set. So I watched it again, and the acting is truly a very high caliber. You have some wonderfully, you've got Donald Sutherland. Fortunately, I'm not going to tell you what happens. You've got Donald Sutherland for a while in the thing. And you know, things happen, you know, in the 12th century. But bad things happen. But you've got some wonderful actors, both well-known ones and some a little less well-known. Mm. How did you, again, this was not the most obvious production for certain people to be in. How did you corral all of these folks?
It's funny, when we sat down the first time and talked about how we were doing the casting, I said to David, we're going to need to cast in a certain way that we can actually place this later. In other words, we will need to make sure we have actors that are known in certain countries, obviously the UK and obviously the US. It was not even a no-brainer. And Priscilla John, who we met through David because of the company, did the most amazing job and helped with those booklets where you have all those different names.
I mean, she kind of knew who worked well where, didn't she?
We helped her in a couple of European countries, but she was very knowledgeable about most of the German actors as well.
I mean,
well.
We got some
great
assist. Again, there was an established working language because of having worked with Priscilla, who partnered with Denise Chamian out of the U.S. And so, I mean, we solicited our casting director on Good Wife. I mean, we utilized any and everybody that we could just to get sort of the expertise within Germany, within Canada, as would help assure that we got the highest caliber of talent possible. I mean, the key was, Ridley in his films, and certainly was our experience in the company as well, is we like organic casting. I mean, it's preferable to be authentic to sort of time and place. So not having any Americans in this, aside from John, was not an issue for any of us. But we obviously had to be cognizant of names that would resonate within
the U.S.
So Rufus and Ian all had series on the air, as had Donald. And so once we were assured that we were able to get certain marquee value, what Priscilla really delivered to us in spades were those sort of first adapters, which was Haley and Eddie, who were lesser known certainly in the U.S., but established a mean in terms of this is who we're going to be able to attract to this picture. And then Rufus was one of the first to come on.
Yes.
And then from there, you know, we really felt like we had a cornerstone to create a cast.
Let's see if the audience has a couple of questions. A lot of things we haven't talked about, including, and that might be something you're interested in, is some of the location shooting and what was involved in that. But whatever, if anybody wants to raise their hand, we will. The first one I see is over there, that gentleman.
Did you have to use Canadian or German writers and directors for the other episodes to satisfy the co-production?
We only had one writer for all of it, John Pielmeyer.
And we only had one director, which was a decision we made early on, primarily because of the complexity of the production, not only for one director to have the vision, but since everything was cross-boarded, it really was impractical to separate them into episodes. Same thing we did on The Company, same as we'll do on World Without End.
Interesting, yes, and we'll get to that in a minute. Yes, right here in the center, if you can pass that mic, would be helpful.
But we did have responsibility to heads of department out of Canada, and there's three actors who are Canadian Alison Pill, who played Maud, Donald Sutherland, and Gordon Pinsent, who played the Archbishop.
Yeah, can you give us the rough proportion of pre-sales, subsidy money, and debt financing as future sales?
No. Otherwise, we'd be giving you all our secrets. But if you would like to present us with a really good project, we can talk afterwards.
But why is that so... Yes, I'm looking at you. Why is that so difficult? I mean, because doesn't it vary with every project? I mean, is it... Or did you discover some secret about how you finance that you want to carry with you into...
No, in terms of the financing, to answer one on the soft money, it's clear. You can get a 20% out of Hungary, depending on what province you're shooting out of Canada. It can vary, but you're averaging about 20% out of Canada. So there is a sort of what the spend is, Canadian spend and Hungarian spend, obviously. In terms of what we got out of the international pre-sales, because a lot of people know which broadcasters came on board.
Oh, I see. You'd be saying what their license fees are.
A little bit. He's, you know, any clever person who's asking that question will cleverly put that pieces together.
Okay. Suffice it to say, have you made your money back on this project? I mean, where are we money-wise in terms of, you know, it hasn't even aired everywhere yet, right?
Yeah.
It's still to air in... No, it's aired in Spain on Cuatro.
It has aired in Spain. Just to take a moment, in terms of making our money, we will make our money. Have we done that yet? No, we have not. But the good news is that we've paid back our loan, FIDEC. In fact, they love us and hate us. We paid it back, but we paid it back too quickly. They didn't make enough money in interest.
Who knew? Yes, they would have preferred you were slower. Okay, there you go. Okay.
But in terms of... The program itself, other than Starz, who had a, and I really want to take a second to talk about this, who recognized for what it was, not only the book, Ken Follett, Scott Free, the support of Ridley doing lots of interviews one-on-one, Ken Follett doing interviews one-on-one, they did a huge campaign, really, an amazing campaign. It was such a pleasure working with them, because they also recognized the package of what it was.
Yes.
The production value, the fact that Oprah Winfrey put it on her book club. This was wonderful stories to tell, but they also were really happy about the production value they got.
So, well, it's the starting of their new branding of their own channel. That's what I meant about it. It was interesting timing having Chris Albrecht come on board.
Absolutely.
And starting to get a new approach to programming. I'm not saying this is the only thing they're doing.
No,
I'm saying
they had
one
good success with Spartacus.
Yes.
So this was showing to their, not only to their subscribers, but potential subscribers, we are bringing yet another high-quality program. And so that was fun to see. Okay. Canada did the same thing with the pay TV networks. And then we went to Ireland, where TV3 had a excellent. Why are you leaving? Are we boring you?
I think because it's really over almost, that's okay.
And then Spain, we broke Spanish television history, just to say that, because it really, really did break Spanish television history in the highest rating. They expected to get 12% market share. They would have been happy with 16% market share. We got 37% market share for them. So needless to say, for any foreign program, it was number one.
And it's going out on ProSieben shortly.
It's going on and Channel 4 in the UK, and Sky Italia just also broke records with the first night on Friday.
I'm going to take this gentleman there in the white shirt that raised his hand. If you can do it loudly. Yes.
It's a good question because we actually talked to the one company in the world which controls 40% of all brands, as we all know, advertising. And
who is that?
Oh, it's MIPCOM. It's
WPP.
WPP is one of the parent companies. And I'm drawing a blank.
Starcom, Zenith. I don't know.
No, it's WPP. Group M. Thank you. And we talked to Group M. They own WPP, MediaCom, all of these companies. and they saw the potential of it, but it's a new business. And for fiction, it's very much a new business. And we couldn't do what Ford, for example, has done, where in the States, Ford has sponsored programs.
But there are no cars in the 12th century. It's a little harder,
this
right?
This was part of the challenge.
We tried beauty products, but it didn't work.
It didn't work.
We even thought about beer, but you know, it still was a little premature. But even then, you know, sometimes these companies are doing it without putting product placement.
I see.
And I'm hoping that the fact that we've proven it, that we've shown that a brand like Pillars and the book, and the fact we've created this franchise with a program, that maybe the group M's of the world will take a look at it. Because at the end of the day, we have to bring the brand and the program together. It's not just about the broadcaster helping a project to have a platform. The advertisers have to get closer to the broadcaster and the program.
So you've got the rights to World Without End. Mm-hmm. You are in prep with that. What's the single biggest lesson from Pillars of the Earth will you apply to this next project?
If there were only one, but you were going to say?
Don't have as many interest fees. It just takes away from the screen. So in other words, try to lock down everything up front.
So you don't have to read all the notes from various people.
No,
it's not
actually,
so it's all the phone calls or just having around.
We spent a lot of money on gap financing. With all due respect, that and it was great to have, but either our financiers have to give us money for lower interest fees, or we have to have built a trust because we've proven it the hard way to have the broadcasters come up front and take the ride with us so that we are not having high expenses.
And as is the case, just speaking to the creative,
yes,
the lessons we learn on serious television, you know, we get some of the benefit here, where through editorial, we made a lot of discoveries about structurally how best to tell a story, particularly the critical importance of the first 30 to 45 minutes of the picture and orienting an audience and at the same time hooking them into sort of the spine of your story. Pillars was incredibly ambitious, and the original screenplay really packed quite a lot of content into those first 20 minutes. And so that was a great discovery process that fortunately we had the time to explore as we're now sort of laying out our plot and outline for World Without End. Hopefully we'll show a great evolution from the first experience.
Do you think the 8-hour... Is the 8-hour format what you have in mind currently for the next one? Because that's
absolutely
a big book too, isn't it?
Mm, yeah, absolutely.
He doesn't write small books.
He does not write small books. All right, I will take one final question.
I have actually two questions. Are all your present partners on Pillars of Earth accompanying you on the next? And the other question is, if you had an American screenwriter, was your director European to keep qualifying for European?
The second question, yes. And you can only do that under the auspices of the Canada-German co-production. Otherwise, if you were doing a Canada, France, or UK, you could not have an American writer. Yeah. So just so you know.
Let me just speak to that for a second. I mean, the search for the director was a particularly challenging one. I don't think in any territory, even the UK where these are a bit more ubiquitous, there are many directors who can take on something of this ambition. So the fact that that was sort of a mandate ultimately served us well because we knew out of the gate that we had to do a global search to try and find the right director for this piece. And it turned out to be a director who's well-known in America and who's had success there, but obviously had the key passport we needed to make him qualify.
And because of his experience in America, he could protect this perspective, this style, let's call it an American style, of editing, pacing, storytelling, which was key for us to bring it back into the U.S., of course. First question was...
Do you have the same broadcasters on board, if I understand rightly?
That's talking about a month.
Okay, not yet, et cetera. All right, I'd like to thank... Because we see all these zeros down there, I think they want us to... They do want us to stop, don't they? Thank you, David.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rola. Thank you, audience.